السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين يا رب العالمين. ثم أما بعد, we're starting the study of Surah Nasr, إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح. This surah comes right after Surah Al-Kafirun in the Mus'haf. We have about four surahs more left before the Mus'haf is done. And this surah is actually directly connected to the message of the previous surah. In the previous surah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told to basically openly declare his separation from the Quraysh by not even calling them. By not even calling them his own people, but rather calling them kafirun. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. In this surah, Allah Azza wa Jal, because that conflict has been declared in the previous surah, this is a surah that guarantees the Messenger of Allah and those who believe with him, رضي الله عنهم أجمعين وصلى الله عليه وسلم, it guarantees all of them victory. And so this is the surah famously known as the surah that brings the help of Allah and the victory, as the first ayah suggests. Also, in the previous surah, we learned لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. So there was a concluding comment, which is commonly very misunderstood as you can have your religion and I can have mine and we can both go our own ways. But that's clearly not the case in the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ. Surah Al-Kafirun is a late Makki surah. What that means is it's at the end of the era of da'wah. For almost a decade or a little more even, the Messenger has been inviting these people to the religion of Islam, and they have not accepted, with very, very few exceptions. And at this point, it's very clear that they have made up their mind. Hence, they're not even called people, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, they're called يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. They're set in their ways, they're going to remain in kufr. The word deen doesn't just mean religion. One of the meanings of deen is also outcome or judgment. And so, when Allah's Messenger tells them, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ, you will have your deen and I will have mine, one of the meanings of that is, you will have the consequences of your religion, and I will have the consequences of mine. And the fate of the religion of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is victory. It is guaranteed. That is what is ahead for him in this dunya and in the next. But the fate of their religion is defeat and humiliation in this dunya and also in the next. I'm happy with this now. Alhamdulillah. Okay. So what we find in this surah is the victory of this deen, and in the next surah, what is the fate of those who disbelieve? Allah gives an example of them, تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ. What happens to those who disbelieve and their fate? So the two have been contrasted. Another thing about this surah that is important to note is that the Messenger والسلام, was told, وَلَا سَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. This is something we studied before, that Allah will give you very soon, He will give you a lot, until you yourself are pleased. This is what Allah guaranteed to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And part of giving the Messenger is removing grief and concern from him. One of the things that gives the Messenger alaihi salatu wasallam a lot of pain is that he delivers the message and people don't take it seriously. They don't believe. And rather they make fun of the message and don't realize how seriously in danger they themselves are if they don't accept this message. And this brings the Messenger alaihi salatu wasallam grief. And imagine he's not only worried about his own tribe. Like all messengers were sent to their own nation, the Messenger of Allah realizes, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if these people don't believe, then there's no talking about the next generation of people, not to mention the rest of the world, because he's the final Messenger of Allah. So the grief is enormous. It's captured in many places in the Quran. For example, when Allah says, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ إِن لَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. Are you going to kill yourself in grief if they don't believe? Out of grief, are you going to kill yourself with worry? So the Messenger is extremely worried. And what will remove his worry is that he sees people actually entering into the religion. And so in that way, this is one of the gifts Allah has given his Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the words, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. That ayah has the word رَأَيْتَ, you saw. The messenger is being told, you get to see for your own eyes that they will enter into the religion, multitudes upon multitudes. In other words, it's not something that will happen after you pass away and you won't know what happened after, but you'll get to see it with your own eyes. So in other words, he dies with satisfaction. You know, compare this to the grief and the concern of Ya'qub alayhi salam. He doesn't know what's going to happen after he's gone, right? So he gathers his children around and he says to them, مَا تَعْبُدُونَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. Who are you going to worship after? What are you going to worship after I'm gone? He's concerned. Similarly, Ibrahim alayhi salam keeps making dua for his future generations because he only sees his immediate generation. He doesn't see the larger, you know, the consequences. What's going to happen in the future generations? But the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam is given this satisfaction to be able to see the growth of his ummah in his own lifetime, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. In the introduction to this surah, a few things. Umar bin al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, this is after the Prophet's passing, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was quizzing the Sahaba. He was taking a tafsir quiz from them. And he recited this surah and he said, tell me about it. So the Sahaba gave their opinion. Some of them said, this is the victory of Allah when Mecca was conquered. This is the surah that guarantees or gave the good news of the final the domination of this deen. And he accepted all of them, and yes, but I'm looking for more. And they turned to a young Sahabi named Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. What's your opinion? And he said, this is the farewell address of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the surah that announces the leaving, the departing of Allah's Messenger. And Umar bin al-Khattab tells him, I was thinking the same thing, but why do you think so? He was thinking the same thing, but why do you think so, Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala? By the way, he's one of the youngest at the time. And he says that every Messenger Allah sends on this earth, he's sent for a purpose. And the purpose is that he deliver the message. And when he finishes his job and he's delivered the message and the people have received the message, then the worldly function, the worldly purpose of the life of that messenger is complete. He is no longer kept in this dunya without a mission. And so when people enter into this deen and the victory has arrived and more people are entering into Islam, it is an indication that the job of the messenger has been accomplished. And that means that it's time for him to leave. When this surah was revealed, it is narrated that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu cried profusely, without any explanation. He just heard the surah and he kept on crying profusely. Similarly, we find some very interesting narrations. We'll discuss them in more detail as the dars continues after salah, inshallah. But Aisha radiallahu anha narrates that the messenger started making a lot more istighfar than he ever did before, after this surah was revealed. Subhanak Allahumma astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Similarly, Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha narrates that he used to repeat Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayhi. We'll read the full narration later on. But sitting, standing, walking, all the time he would recite this over and over again. And she said to him, tukathir. You know, you've added a lot more than you used to before in terms of this dhikr. And he said, لِأَنَّهُ أَمَرَنِي بِهِ, because I've been commanded to do so. And he recited this surah, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. Why? Because at the end of the surah we find, وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. The messenger is commanded, seek istighfar. So the messenger increased his istighfar. A lot of scholars also comment that the famous hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he tells us that in any given day he makes istighfar at least 100 times, is mentioned after this surah was revealed. That after this surah, the messenger increased his practice of istighfar. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Also, he increased a special dhikr of istighfar in sajda. And this is not commonly known. Subhanakallahumma rabbana wa bihamdik Allahumma ghfirli. This is what he would add in his sajda after this surah was revealed. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu actually comments that after this surah was revealed, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam would start praying a lot more than he did even before. He was already a man of a lot of, you know, qiyam. Of course the fard, but constantly making nawafil. But he increased even what he had, so much so that his feet would swell and they would be in pain. So narration after narration after narration telling us that this surah had a very deep and profound impact on the personal life of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Half of this surah is dealing with something that happened on the outside. And this is something we'll, inshallah, by the time we tie this dars up, it'll make more sense to you. But half of this surah, or more than half really, the first two ayat are dealing with one subject, the victory of Islam in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The last ayah is dealing with the practice of the Messenger himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as far as praising Allah, remembering Allah, doing dhikr of Allah, and asking Allah's forgiveness. So what are the first two things? What was the first thing, the victory of Islam, have to do with the messenger seeking forgiveness? How are the two things connected? That is something we will explore, inshallah ta'ala, as this dars continues. The important thing I want to get to before the salah break, though we have about 10 or so minutes, is a discussion among ulama about the historical context in which the surah is revealed. They are divided. The majority of ulama say that this is a Madani surah, and a minority says that this is a Makki surah. So I'll share with you the opinions of the majority first. The majority that says this is a Madani surah, they say either it was revealed at the time Mecca was conquered, at Fath Mecca, or it was revealed a couple of years before then at Hajjatul Wida', so at the farewell Hajj it was revealed. Or they say that the Prophet ﷺ was reciting it as he was entering Mecca, but that suggests that it was already revealed and he was repeating it to himself as he was riding the camel when he ﷺ enters the city of Mecca as a victor. And by the way, he entered with his forehead on the camel and his beard was touching the skin, you know, the camel itself, suggesting that he entered in a state of sajda. He entered in a state of humility ﷺ. But the minority does say it's Makki, and it's kind of peculiar. When I first read that, some scholars did actually say that this is a Makki surah too, I found it very difficult to understand at first. Because, you know, clearly it's talking about the victory, Fath Makkah, this is a Madani incident. So what will lead them to believe that this is a Makki surah? We'll look at their opinions also. First of all, they say there's a different way of looking at those narrations. You remember Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma and the question Umar had asked him? They say there's a different way of looking at that narration. In other words, what Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma is saying is, when those things happen, when the victory of when the help of Allah comes and the victory arrives and the people enter into Islam in multitudes, then we know that it's time for the messenger to leave. It doesn't necessarily mean it happened already. In other words, this surah they look at as a guarantee of the victory rather than looking back and commenting on the victory that already took place. So they're looking at it in that sense as a Makki surah. The second evidence they use is the use of the word idha. In Arabic, you know, in the English translation, if you're reading one, as we follow along, idha ja'a nasrullah, when the help of Allah, right? When, the word when is the word idha. But in the Arabic language, there's another word for when, which is idh. So there's idh and idha. Now, you know, idh is used in the Quran also, like idh zaghatil absar wa balagatil qulubul hanajir, right? Idh qala li abihi. So we find the word idh means when, and idha also means when. Now what's the difference between them? Idh refers to the word when if it's referring to something in the past. And idha commonly is referring to something in the future. Let me give you a simple example in English. Because in English we just have one word, which is when. But the Arabs have two words, so we have to make a distinction. Idh, for instance. When I told you that I'll be here, I meant it. When I use that sentence, as an example, when I told you I'll be here, am I referring to something that I said in the past? Right? Then I would use idh. But if I say, when I come here, be ready. When I come here, be ready. Am I referring to something in the past or the future now? The future, that would be idha. That would be idha. Now this is found in the Quran. For example, إِذَا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا وَفَارَتْ تَنُورِ. Actually, that's the exception. There are only two places, arguably three places in the Quran where إِذَا is used for the past. But before I get to the exceptions, let's look at the common case. Allah says, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ إِذَا. Then He says, إِذَا النُّجُومِ إِذَا الْجِبَالِ إِذَا الْعِشَارِ إِذَا الْوُحُوشِ إِذَا الْبِحَارِ إِذَا النُّفُوسِ. All of those instances in Surah Al-Takwir are referring to something that happens in the future. Similarly, إِذَا السَّمَاءُ انشقت. إِذَا. When the sky is torn open, right? Similarly, إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا. When the earth is shaken. All of these إِذَا instances referring to something that happens in the future. So commonly, إِذَا for the future and إِذْ for the past. But there are exceptions. Exceptionally, in the case of Nuh alayhi salam, Allah says, إِذَا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا وَفَارَتْ تَنُّورِ. Then when our decision finally came and the kettle boiled over, referring to the valleys, you know, the valleys in the region of Nuh alayhi salam as forming a kettle. And it boiled over. You know, when a kettle boils over, the water slips over. So the water filled over in the mountains and tipped over like a dam breaking. And that's how it's describing the kettle tipping over. But the word idha is used for the future, for the past in that case. Or idha balagha maghriba shams in Surah Al-Kahf. When Dhulqarnain is traveling and he reaches the setting of the sun, meaning he reaches the west coast and he gets really far into the west, then idha is used also referring to something in the past. And the final case, which goes both ways, is in Surah Al-Munafiqun. In Surah Al-Munafiqun, Allah says, إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ, in the very beginning. إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ. And Mufassirun have understood that ayah in two ways. One is, when the hypocrites came to you. Now when I translated that, when the hypocrites came to you, what tense did I use? Past. Another way it's been interpreted by Mufassirun because of إِذَا is, whenever the hypocrites come to you. Now when I translated that way, whenever the hypocrites may come to you or come to you, now I'm referring to it in the future. Nonetheless, in Arabic literature, the norm is to use إِذَا for the future. And that seems to be one of the stronger arguments used by this group of scholars to say that this is in fact a surah that is Makki, making a promise of the future. They tie this argument to another thing. In the Qur'an, Allah Azza wa Jal in many, many occasions, both Makki and Madani, has given a guarantee of victory to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For example, multiple times this ayah occurs, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. This occurs multiple times. He, Allah, is the one who sent his messenger with guidance in the religion of truth, so that it may overcome all the other ways of life, all the other deen, all the other religions. So the guarantee of Allah's victory. Then in Surah Ali Imran, at the occasion of Uhud, Allah says, قُلْ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَتُغْلَبُنَّ وَلَتُحْشَرُنَّ إِلَى جَهَنَّمْ وَبِئْسَ الْمِهَادِ. Tell the disbelievers, or tell those who have disbelieved, you will be overcome and you will be gathered towards hellfire. So two things were told to them. Number one, you will be overcome. غَلَبَ, to dominate. You will be dominated. And second, you'll be gathered to go to hell. What's really interesting about that is this two-part warning that's given to the kuffar in that surah, لَتُغْلَبُنَّ وَلَتُحْشَرُنَّ إِلَى جَهَنَّمْ, that same sequence occurs here. In this surah, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ, it's the part لَتُغْلَبُنَّ. They are overcome because the help of Allah came and the victory came. What about being dragged into hellfire? That's the next surah. تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُ مَالُهُ وَمَا كَسَبْ. And then, سَيَصْلَى نَارًا نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبْ. Right? So, being overcome and then being cast into the hellfire, that sequence occurs at the end of Qur'an also. A very interesting ayah. When the Messenger was making hijrah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was heartbroken. He was absolutely heartbroken. Makkah is where his heart is. This is his home. This is where he was born. And when he was making hijrah, Allah revealed an ayah to him to calm his heart. The ayah is, إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لَرَادُّكَ إِلَى مَعَادٍ. The one who has made the Qur'an mandatory upon you, meaning the one who's revealed it upon you and made it mandatory for you to live by it and to deliver it, that same one will make you return to the same place. He'll bring you back to the original place. So as the Messenger is leaving Mecca, Allah said, no doubt about it, I'll bring you back. So He gave him that guarantee, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the second, very important, we find this in Surah Safat, وَلَقَدْ سَبَقَتْ كَلِمَتُنَا لِعِبَادِنَا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. I'll go ayah by ayah. Our word, our promise has already been delivered to our slaves that have been sent as messengers. إِنَّهُمْ لَهُمُ الْمَنْصُورُونَ. It is they truly, and only they, that are going to be aided, that are going to be given help. Meaning Allah guarantees that every one of His messengers will be given help. But then He says, وَإِنَّ جُنْدَنَا لَهُمُ الْغَالِبُونَ. And no doubt our army, it is only they, and especially they, that will be dominant. So in a Makki surah, already Allah gave the victory, the guarantee that the army of Allah will be dominant. In light of all of this, this minority of scholars looking at the surah, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ, they say that this is a Makki surah, making a guaranteed promise of the future. The final argument they use is the next surah. The next surah is about Abu Lahab and how he's going to be destroyed. That by the almost ijma' of the Mufassirun is a Makki surah. But we know that Abu Lahab was not destroyed in Mecca. Actually, his death comes much later. But the guarantee is given earlier, which makes part of the benefits of Surah Lahab is the miraculous promise of Surah Lahab. Abu Lahab could have turned around and said, okay, your Quran says that I'm going to die a disbeliever and go into hellfire. You know what? I accept Islam. And for years he didn't. And the reason that he didn't, Allah had already declared his faith. And he could have. He's a very clever enemy of Islam. And if he did, it would make the Qur'an look invalid. But he didn't. So it was part of the miracle of the Qur'an that he would remain in his kufr, and he would die in that state. Similarly, the argument is if the next surah is a miraculous surah guaranteeing an event of the future, this surah is also. That this surah came to talk about the help of Allah and the victory that is guaranteed to His Messenger والسلام, much in the past. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So the evidence is, once again, just as a recap, the use of the word idha, and then also the fact that this kind of promise has been made elsewhere in the Quran many, many, many times. The final comment before I let you go for the salah break, which is in a minute, inshallah, just to get the introductory comments out of the way, is that this year, when the Mecca was conquered, which is what the majority of scholars say, the word fath in this surah, victory, is referring to fath Mecca, the conquest and the opening of Mecca. When this is mentioned, this year is also called Aam al-Wufud. This is the year of ambassadors. These ambassadors, these representatives came from many, many, many different places, from Ta'if, from Yemen, from Hawazin. They came in groups of 40 and 80 and 100 and 200. And they came and they spent a couple of days with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. They heard the message of Islam. The whole bunches of them would accept Islam, take it back to their tribes, and the entire tribe would become Muslim. So in a very short amount of time, a lot of different ambassadors from all over the Arab world came to meet with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam in this particular year, and people started accepting the religion, multitude after multitude after multitude. Contrast this with the Messenger going to the people. A decade ago, the Messenger is going around delivering the message and people are laughing at him. And now the Messenger is sitting in Mecca and people are coming to him to learn about Islam. How Allah turns the tides, and how Allah Azza wa Jal gives aid to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these were some introductory comments about the surah. After the Maghrib prayer, inshallah ta'ala, we'll begin the dars of the surah word by word itself. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyaakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين. We'll begin إن شاء الله تعالى our درس of إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح. We'll begin with the word جاء. I did talk to you a little bit about before the Maghrib prayer about the difference between إذ and إذا, so we've covered that a little bit already. So we're looking at the word جَاءَ. A similar word in Arabic is the word أَتَى. So جَاءَ means to come. أَتَى also means to come. So what's the difference between them? We'll read some commentary. القرآن الكريم يستعمل أَتَى لما هو أيسر من جَاءَ. The Quran uses the word أَتَى. It is easier and softer in connotation than the word جَاءَ. يعني المجيء فيه صعوبة بالنسبة لأَتَى. In other words, the word جَاءَ is stronger and it's tougher, it's heavier in connotation than the word أَتَى. ولذلك يكاد يكون هذا طابع عام في القرآن الكريم ولذلك لم يأتي فعل جاء بالمضارع. And this is why the word أتى يأتي is also more fluid, because you can conjugate it. In other words, it comes in past tense, it comes in present tense, even in مصدر form. But the word جاء is only found in the past tense, even when you refer to something in the future. You don't say يجيء, you just say جاء. It only occurs in that tense. جزاكالله خير. Then the other thing is, قال تعالى فإذا جاءت الصاخة, when الصاخة, the heavy coming, when it arrives, جاء is used. Something, it's not used for something light. Similarly, فشديدة, فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى, something big also, again, جاء is used. Similarly, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in this surah, إذا جاء نصر الله, is not something small that came. The help of Allah is not something small. So the word أتى is not appropriate here. The word جاء is part of the perfection of Quran. هذا أمر عظيم, هذا نصر لا يأتي بسهولة. First of all, this is a huge matter. This is not something that came easily. The help of Allah did not just arrive one day out of nowhere. You know, وإنما حروب ومعارك. It came after a lot of battles. It came after a lot years of da'wah and sweat and struggle. Then finally, the help of Allah Azza wa Jal arrived. So it's not something small. We'll see why also جَاءَ is important, because Allah didn't just say إذا جاء النصر, ولكنه قال إذا جاء نصر الله فأضاف النصر إلى الله. So he added the word Allah to the word نصر, making it even heavier. And adding the word Allah, we'll look at the benefits in a second, but let's explore the word Nasr a little more. So that was a little about Ja'a, what came, when it came. But now the word help itself. The word Nasr in Arabic, the literal definition, if you want to go for a simple definition, Al-Awn, ma'khudh min qawlihim qad nasr al-ghayth al-ard. This is, literally the word means a lot of help. And it's used, for example, when the earth is dried up and it's not producing any vegetation, and then the rain comes. So they say the rain did nasr for the earth, meaning it brought it to life, it relieved it of its suffering and its dryness. That's how it's used. إِذَا أَعَانَ عَلَى نَبَاتِهَا, in other words. But there are other Arabic words in the Qur'an itself, like Abdurrahman Kilani in his famous Mutaradifatul Qur'an, he wrote a book of synonyms in the Qur'an. He tells us all the different words in Arabic that are used for help. A'ana, ista'ana, ayyada, azzara, azzaza, zahara, rafada, even amada or amadda rather. All these different words are used for helping. But each of these words has their own flavor. So what specific kind of help is nasr? What specific kind of help is nasr? By the way, a different word for help we use in the Fatiha. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. We don't say nastansir, we say nasta'in. Okay, because that's am, it's more general. All kinds of help, nasta'in. But this is a very particular kind of help. Nasr in Arabic actually refers to help against an oppressor. Help against, if you're in some serious trouble, then you don't need awn, you need nasr. You need nasr. So it's help against an oppressor, help against affliction, help when an army is being defeated. Not something small. Nasr is not a small kind of help. Like if you have a flat tire, you're not asking for nasr. Right? That's just some musa'ada, some help. But it's not nasr. But when, for example, a country calls on another country for additional military support or something like that, you would have to call that nasr. Because it's very big, it's very heavy. Similarly, the word nasr is not used except when it's meant to overpower someone else. In other words, you're helping someone against someone else. It is one thing to help someone, but it's another to help someone fight off someone else. And that's when there's another party involved that you're going to fight against, or you're going to go against, then the word nasr is used. Now, let's look at the word Allah. What Allah didn't just say nasr came, he said nasrullah came, right? The aid, the tremendous aid of Allah came. So by adding the word Allah, what benefits does it have? For example, first of all, ta'zeeman lin nasr. It's not just any help now, it's some amazing help. And the description of that help is that it's Allah's help. Allah could have said nasran azeeman, like for fath, he said fatham mubina. Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. He described the fath as a clear and open victory. Or success can be described as great success. Thalika huwa al-fawzul azeem. It's great success. But here Allah didn't just say help, He said the help of Allah, of Allah. Now that adding of the of Allah, it magnifies this help. What it does is a few things. First of all, there are other things that Allah created that He talks about in the Quran where He added Himself like that. He did. For example, Allah talks about the she-camel that was sent to Salih alayhi salam. He doesn't just call it an-naqa, He says naqatullah. Right? فَقَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نَاقَةَ اللَّهِ. Now the she-camel of Allah. So the word Allah was attributed, that it belongs to Allah. Similarly, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْحُطَمَةِ نَارُ اللَّهِ الْمُوْقَدَةِ. The fire of Allah. Now when the word Allah is added in that way, you know what that means? That whatever that thing is, fire can be compared to any fire. A camel can be compared to any camel. But when you add the camel of Allah, or the fire of Allah, that is a kind of fire that can never be compared to any fire. That is a kind of camel that will never be compared to any camel. So when he says Nasrullah, what does that mean? It's the kind of help that will never be comparable. There will be no help in human history that will ever be able to compare with the help Allah gave His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. The word Allah has these benefits embedded inside of it. The second benefit here is in the previous surah, in Suratul Kafirun, right before this surah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was given a very clear commandment. The kuffar came and they were trying to make some kind of compromise. Why don't you follow our religion for 1 year and we'll follow your religion for 1 year, everybody will be happy. So they're trying to make a deal because they were tired of the da'wah and they're not getting rid of him and they can't argue back with him, so they came up with this deal basically, right? So now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is told, they're thinking that they're making deals with you. You're not the one they're dealing with. Who are they making deals with? Allah, so the surah didn't even begin, Ya ayyuhal kafirun, it began, Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun. You tell them, kafirun. In other words, the surah begins telling them, I'm not even speaking on my own behalf. I'm being told to tell you, you're kafirun. And there's no compromise. There's no compromise. And by the way, when the messenger was making his own decisions, even before Risala came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was making his own decisions, even then he didn't compromise. So how is it possible that after he becomes a messenger, he's going to compromise? That's not even possible. What I'm trying to get at though is, in the previous surah, the doors to compromise were closed because it was told that this man is not bringing you a message from himself, he's bringing a message from Allah Azza wa Jalla, and there's no room for compromise there. This surah goes further to say, not only is he not going to compromise with you, but by the way, he doesn't have to compromise with you, because they're thinking, you know, he's weak, he's by himself. He's going to have to compromise, he's going to play ball a little bit, you know. What support does he have? This surah comes along and says, no, you know, here's another reason he's not going to compromise with you. He's got the help of Allah on his side. What do you have on your side that compares? You know, on this note, I want to share with you something very powerful. There are places in the Quran where Allah Azza wa Jal talks about a contrast, a comparison between believers and disbelievers. Allah Azza wa Jal, for example, says, Allahu waliyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. Right? Walladhina kafaru awliya'uhum at-taghut fil Baqarah. Right? He says that Allah is the protective friend of those who believe. He brings them out of darkness into light. Allah calls himself wali. Allah calls himself wali. Wali means a friend who wants to protect you. In other words, in English I'm saying protective friend. Protective friend. And when it came to the kuffar, what did he say? وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَوْلِيَاؤُهُمْ الطَّاغُوتِ. The kuffar, the disbelievers, they also have protective friends. But who are they? الطَّاغُوتِ, those who want to rebel. The exceedingly rebellious against Allah are their awliya. Awliya is the plural of wali. Wali, once again, I want you to remember, means protective friend. What that means in simple terms, a friend who wants to protect you. Now, that's the word wali. There's another word in the Quran, and that word is mawla. There's the word wali in Arabic. What's the other word? Mawla. Mawla in Arabic means a protecting friend. Mimwalat. A protecting friend. So there's a protective friend, and there's a protecting friend. What's the difference? A protective friend has the intention of protecting you, wants to protect you, is protective of you, has that feeling. But a protecting friend is actually engaged in protecting you. He doesn't just have a feeling, doesn't just want to, he's actually doing it too. Now look at this comparison in Surah Muhammad. Allah Azza wa Jal says, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ مَوْلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. That is because Allah is the mawla of الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, of those who believe. Allah is the wali of believers and also their mawla, both. Now who was the wali of the kuffar, you remember? At-taghut. Let's see who their mawla is. Who's protecting them? وَأَنَّ الْكَافِرِينَ لَا مَوْلَى لَهُمْ. And as far as disbelievers are concerned, they have no mawla whatsoever. They have no mawla. They have wali, but they don't have mawla. They may have someone who wants to protect them, but they actually have nobody physically protecting them. They have no protection against Allah Azza wa Jal. There's no one there. So when this surah, when the help of Allah comes, it becomes abundantly clear why the messenger is in no need. Is not interested in any way, shape, or form for any kind of compromise. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. This is the kind of guarantee that was given to Musa alayhi salam. He has to go talk to Fir'aun. That's not a small task. You know, you go talk to a king, and a king, you know, it's not like in this, you know, in modern societies where you have rule of law and you have, you know, arrest him and take him to court and there'll be a proceeding. The king is the law. He can tell, kill him right now, kill him right now. There's no questions asked. And Fir'aun, he loves saying kill them. I mean, he kills babies for God's sake. He's a genocidal maniac. And Musa alayhi salam is to go talk to him, not just talk to him. Not, you know, it's one thing to go and say, how's it going, Fir'aun? How's it been? Long time. You know, make small talk. What does he have to do? He has to go directly challenge him, publicly. So you know, one of the fears, and on top of that, Musa alayhi salam has got a murder, you know, on his rap sheet. وَلَهُمْ عَلَيَّ ذَنْبٌ فَأَخَافُ وَيَقْتُلُونَ. What did Allah tell him? كَلَّا. Don't worry about it. They're not going to kill you. They're not going to kill you. Allah gave him a guarantee. Because Musa alayhi salam had a guarantee, he could go talk there. There's no need for him to compromise. There's no need for him to back down. He could say whatever he has to say without thinking twice about it. Because he has what with him? The guarantee from Allah. Not a problem. Nothing will happen. كَلَّا فَاذْهَبَ بِآيَاتِنَا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ مُسْتَمِعُونَ. SubhanAllah. This is the guarantee Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been given in this surah. So not only this surah is making it clear, therefore, the previous surah made clear that he is the recipient of Allah's message in the word qul. This surah makes clear, not only does he receive Allah's message, he is also the recipient of Allah's help. Now, this surah also happens to be, by some commentary, the response to a challenge in the Qur'an. The response, rather, to a complaint in the Qur'an. أَمْ حَسِبْتُ مَنْ تَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ Allah asked believers, have you assumed you're just going to enter Jannah just like that? وَلَمَّا يَأْتِكُمْ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ And the things that happened to the people before you didn't happen to you yet. The problems they suffered, you haven't suffered them yet. You think you're just going to walk into Jannah? And then he says, مَسَّتْهُمُ الْبَأْسَاءُ وَالضَّرَّاءُ وَزُلْزِلُ They were touched with difficulty and extreme harsh conditions, and the ground beneath their feet was shaken. حَتَّى يَقُولَ الرَّسُولُ Until even the messenger who was with them, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ And those who believed with him, what did they say? مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ When is the help of Allah coming? Meaning there were people before who were with their messenger, and they delivered the message, and they were tortured and persecuted and put in such difficult conditions that even the messenger, the words came out of a messenger's mouth. When is Allah's help coming? And Allah responded, Allah, you had better know, Inna nasrallahi qareeb. No doubt about it, the help of Allah is near. The help of Allah is near. And this surah seems to respond with a guarantee. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ So there he said it's near, and here it came. SubhanAllah. Then additionally, this is, you know, the word nasr in Arabic, you know, any word in Arabic, because of morphology, because of how you can change words, can be used in different forms. It can be used as a verb, it can be used as a noun, right? So for example, in the occasion of Badr, Allah used the word nasr as a verb. He said, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ Allah aided you at the occasion of Badr. وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٍ And you were powerless. You were pathetic by yourselves. Allah is the one who gave you aid at the occasion of Badr. This ayah occurs in Ali Imran. But there the word nasr is used in verb form. Now in Arabic linguistics, the verb is considered weaker and the noun is considered stronger. Allah aided the believers at Badr, but he used a verb, which is the weaker form. But when the complete help came, the complete help after which there's no more, you know, the case is closed completely. After Badr, the case is not closed. The case is still open. But after this victory, after the conquest of Makkah, the case is closed. It's done. It's finished. It's not. There's no more Quraysh to battle with. That chapter is finished. So then the noun was used, the stronger version is used, Nasr. إِذَا جَاءَ Nasr. He didn't just say, إِذَا نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهِ You know, وَالْفَتْحِ So here, the noun form being used actually alludes to the stronger help from Allah Azza wa Jal. Then we find another correlation with something Allah had said before. Allah had said, إِن يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ If Allah decides to help you, if Allah brings His help, then there is absolutely no one who will be able to overpower you. That will become impossible. And that is exactly what Allah Azza wa Jal did. He delivered Nasr, but also with it, what's the next word after إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ That word Fath will make it clear why it's impossible for anyone to overcome once again. Then also in this, you know, this is something where we fall into this sometimes. You know how they talk about the 100 most influential men and they put the Rasulullah as number one? You know, we take pride in that and stuff. And they talk about his military conquests and how he was a great leader and all of that. And we agree, except there's one problem. When it came to victory and the help, Allah Azza wa Jal took the credit Himself. He took the credit Himself. And this is what He's teaching us in this surah. When the victory came, the kafir will give credit to who? Oh, Muhammad won. Right? Because they won't even say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We do. Right? But when we hear about the help, who do we give credit to? We give credit to Allah Azza wa Jal, that the messenger gave his help, that Allah gave his help to the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ And by the way, if the credit goes to Allah, then the thanks should also go to Allah Azza wa Jal. The thanks should go to Allah. So it's only natural that at the end of the surah, we are taught to thank Allah and to make dhikr of Him. فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُ It's only natural. If He's the one who's the cause of the victory, then He should be the one we should be making hamd of. Then, another very important concept when it comes to this nasr, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ Allah says in Surah Al-Saff, هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ تِجَارَةٍ تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ Should I tell you about a trade that will rescue you from a painful punishment. Allah makes an offer to the believers. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, those of you who claim to believe, should I tell you of a trade that will save you, that will rescue you from a painful punishment? Tu'minuna billahi wa rasulihi, that you should believe in Allah and His Messenger. وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ, that you should make jihad, make struggle as much as you can, and also includes fight in the path of Allah with your monies and yourselves. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ, that would be better for you. إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ, if you in fact knew. And the ayah goes on to say, what additional thing should we give you? يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, not only will He give you Jannah, He will cover your sins. وَيُدْخِلْكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ, enter you into gardens. You've heard these ayat many times before. He'll enter you into gardens at the foots of which rivers are flowing. After all of this, he says something very interesting. He says, وَأُخْرَى تُحِبُّونَهَا, and additionally, you would love something. نَصْرٌ, جزاكَ خَيْرًا. I was holding on to it. وَأُخْرَى تُحِبُّونَهَا, and additionally, you would love. Now, what would you love in addition? نَصْرٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيبٌ. نَصْرٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيبٌ, that amazed, a great help should come from Allah, or some help should come from Allah, and that victory should be near. Now it's a very interesting passage in Surah As-Saff. On the one hand, Allah says, let me tell you what you should get. Should I give you a deal? And here's what I'm offering you. You do this for me, Iman and Jihad, you do these two things for me, and what will you get? You'll get Jannah, you'll get forgiveness. And then after giving us that, he says, but by the way, you're also interested in something more. Secondarily, ukhra, secondarily, you know what else you want? You want the help from Allah in this dunya, and you want victory also in this dunya. So the believers are being told, you want Jannah, but you also want victory. But which one was first? Allah put the quest for paradise first. The quest for forgiveness from Allah first. سَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. The Sahaba are running in battle towards victory, and Allah tells them, no, you're not running towards victory, you're running towards your forgiveness. سَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. SubhanAllah. Because it's a different perspective. So the victory of this world, nonetheless, we want Allah's paradise, but it's a desire in every believer's heart that they should see the victory of Islam on this earth too. They should see that victory. The Sahaba have that desire in their hearts. But it's not primary, it should be secondary. Now, this is the concept that we have to be very, very clear about. This help of Allah, when it came, it means both things. It means Allah Azza wa Jal has completed the mission for Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The help of Allah came, meaning not only the help of Allah in conquering Makkah, the help of Allah in letting the Messenger finish his mission, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that means that he is successful as far as Allah is concerned. That's a bigger concern for the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. Getting Makkah conquered and getting the victory of Islam on this earth is a secondary thing compared to him fulfilling his mission that Allah has charged him with, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that help from Allah came. But there also the same two words were used. نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيبٌ. Here, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. But here what I wanted to highlight is the difference between نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ and نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. In Surah As-Saff we read, نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ. Here we are reading, نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. So some help from Allah as opposed to the help of Allah. What's the difference? When you say نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ in rhetoric, in balagha, they say this is تَبْعِيد. This is distancing two words from each other. What that means is you're hoping for some help to come. The believers are hoping some help should come. Allah says, what to speak of some help? I'll give you all the help. Nasrullah. So when it came time to giving, Allah gave even greater. It's greater than Nasrum min Allah. Nasrullah is more. Nasrullah is more. But when they were hoping for some, and Allah Azza wa Jal gave them even more. SubhanAllah. This is a gift from Allah Azza wa Jal. Now let's talk a little bit about the word Al-Fatih. Alhamdulillah. Another word used for victory in the Quran besides Fatih is Adhfara. Adhfara. That's also used in Surah Muhammad. But here literally Fatih means to, you know, Fataha in Arabic means to open. It's also used for victory. But when it's used for victory, it's used for a special kind of victory that makes it clear who the victor is and who the loser is. You know, sometimes there's a very close match. You know, it could go either way and you barely won. That's not Fatih. Fath is when you won decisively. The matter has been completely opened and cleared up. There is no confusion who won and who lost. And especially the people who lost are clear that they lost. You ever seen this nowadays, especially in politics? The guy loses the election and says, I didn't lose. Recount it. Right? That's not Fath then. You know what that is? That's barely winning. Maybe Zafar, but it's not Fath. Fath is absolutely, abundantly clear. The victor, the winner knows he won, and the loser knows he lost. It's very, very clear. That's the kind of help that Allah Azza wa Jalla sends. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. Now, here also, we have to explore this word in some depth. And here we come to a very important, very difficult concept actually. Allah Azza wa Jalla told the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the occasion of Hudaybiyah. At the occasion of Hudaybiyah. That's called Surah Al-Fath, by the way. The Surah Al-Fath deals with Hudaybiyah. In the very beginning of that surah, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina." No doubt we have given you an open, clear, manifest, unconfused victory. This victory is absolutely clear. This Allah said at the occasion of what? Hudaybiyah. But if you look at the treaty of Hudaybiyah, you find something interesting. In Hudaybiyah, a lot of the points in the treaty are not in the favor of the Muslims, they're against them. If somebody from Makkah escapes and makes their way to Medina, what are you supposed to do? According to Hudaybiyah, send it back. Can you go make Hajj this year? The Sahaba came in Ihram, they brought their sacrificial animals. They didn't just take a flight from Makkah to Medina to Makkah. They walked it, right? It's a long, difficult journey. They get there, and after this treaty, can they make Hajj this year or no? Go back, take your Ihram off. None of this seems like a victory. By the way, it's so difficult. The Sahaba were so frustrated that Allah Azza wa Jal had to, you know, there's one thing, to, you know, the Messenger's trying to calm them down. But it seems even that wasn't enough. When the Messenger came and gave them the news about the treaty, Umar ibn al-Khattab snapped. He regretted that for the rest of his life, by the way. Why should we back down? We have the truth. The Messenger ﷺ commanded the people to take the ihram off, to shave their head. They wouldn't do so. And then of course he gets the advice from his spouse, you know, radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers. But besides that, how then did the Sahaba calm down? Allah told us in Surah Al-Fath. فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَى رَسُولِهِ. And then also عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ later on. He sent his tranquility, Allah sent the tranquility upon his messenger and upon the believers. The believers' hearts were so disturbed, the only thing that would have calmed them down is tranquility that came directly from Allah Azza wa Jalla. It was that frustrating an occasion. But in that frustrating occasion, Allah calls it what? A victory. And not just a victory, you know, fathan qaleelan saghiran. No, mubinan. Open, clear, uncompromised victory. So everybody sees this as a defeat, and Allah sees it as a victory. And this is incredible. This is incredible. If you look at it from a political science point of view, you'll learn something amazing. And I probably won't be able to finish dars on the surah today, but I do want to get this point across to you folks very, very clearly. There are two kinds of fath in the Quran. There's the fath of Hudaybiyah, and then there's the fath of Makkah. And we have to understand the relationship between these two. I'm going to speak to you a little bit out of the box. I will not quote scholars and stuff like that, just to get this point across, so you understand these things in a little bit more depth, inshallah ta'ala. You see, when the Messenger began his cause, when he was given the message and he started his cause, he started calling people to La ilaha illallah, and people started believing, slowly, little by little, the larger society saw them as strange. They saw them as a weird group that is trying to do things differently from everyone else. You see, in psychology we learn, you know what abnormal behavior is? What's the definition of abnormal psychological behavior in psychology? You know what it is? The definition is, if someone does something nobody else is doing, they must be abnormal. That's the definition. So if everybody's talking in English and some guy starts talking to you in Chinese out of nowhere and doesn't stop, that's considered abnormal behavior. Every car is going this way, one guy wants to go that way, clearly abnormal behavior, right? So abnormal behavior is you do something that nobody else is doing. That's their definition. By that definition, do the Quraysh think that the Sahaba and the Messenger and the Sahaba are engaged in abnormal behavior? Sure. They're doing something nobody else is doing. And especially in the beginning, one or two people as opposed to an entire city, of course they'll be considered, and you know, it's only understandable from the kafir's point of view, they call them insane. They call them possessed, they call them disturbed. Then they started calling them a cult. They're going to cut you off from your family. That's what cults do, right? They take you away from your family and you become a, you know, think by yourself, cut off from society. These are the kinds of allegations they made against the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the Sahaba kept at it, and they grew and they grew and they grew. When they grew, then you don't just call them crazy anymore. You got to come up with something else. Now these guys are too big. Now they're becoming a threat. Now they're considered a threat. They're dangerous. They're dangerous. We have to get, you know, we have to physically attack them. We have to get rid of them from our city. We have to persecute them because they are causing disruption in the society. So instead of just, you know, going off on the offensive against them by character assassination, now you go further and you start calling them a threat. In modern terms, you can call them a dangerous group, right? Or a terrorist group or whatever, right? They're a terror to society. Get rid of them. Fine. And by the way, when there's a government and there's a group, and the government and that group don't get along, then the government never negotiates with them. We're not going to deal with them. We will never deal with them. We will annihilate them, or we will get them expelled from this land, but we will not bring them on the table because we don't recognize them. They were never recognized, right? Now, for the longest time, the Quraysh never recognized the legitimacy of the leadership of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even when he moved to Medina, they didn't recognize his legitimacy. They fought him. They fought him and they fought him and they fought him. And finally, they realized his strength has grown so much and he is so powerful that he doesn't even have to bring swords and armor and shields to come up to us in Mecca. He came unarmed, barely armed, just to slaughter the animals. They brought daggers, but they didn't come armed for battle. They came armed to make Hajj. They realized this man and his group has become so strong that we have no choice but to recognize them now as a legitimate entity to be dealt with. And you know how you recognize someone as a legitimate entity? You engage in a treaty with them. You engage in a peace treaty or agreement with them officially. What is Hudaybiyah? It's a treaty, it's an agreement. Well, you know what that means? For the first time, the Quraysh have actually officially recognized the might and the authority of the Messenger of Allah and the believers. They've recognized that authority. And if they recognize that authority, that is a huge political step. Politically speaking, it's a huge step. And by the way, after this step, this news gets out to the entire Arabian Peninsula. Man, even the Quraysh recognize them? They must be something serious. And so what happens in the few years between Hudaybiyah, which was considered a loss, by human eyes it was considered a loss, but Allah sees something more. In between that and the conquest of Mecca, what happens in between? All these different tribes, the Messenger is going to them and saying, look, either sign up with us or sign neutrality agreement. Either you'll be neutral or you'll be with us, but sign one of the two. And tribe after tribe after tribe is adding on, it's tacking on with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what's happening? The influence of Rasulullah walladhina ma'ahu, the influence of Allah's Messenger is expanding. And by definition, therefore, the influence of the Quraysh is what? It's shrinking. It's shrinking. No battles necessary. No bloodshed necessary. No arms necessary. Just by that treaty, they signed their own death warrant. That treaty was the end of Quraysh. Until they expanded so much that they came to Hajj with so many numbers that there didn't even have to be a fight. And Makkah is conquered. That fatḥ led to this fatḥ. But that was fathan with tanween. Inna fatahna laka fathan, which is less. Here he says, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْأَلْفَ, the victory, the final victory. The final decisive victory. That was a great victory, but it wasn't the ultimate victory yet. This one is though. So that one leads to this one. You understand the connection between the two? It's very important that we understand these connections in the Quran. And we understand the strategy that was employed, that was revealed to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, but which led to this victory. The victory didn't come as the result of battle. No, the victory came because of Hudaybiyah, and Hudaybiyah in and of itself was a recognition by the Quraysh of the legitimacy of Islam. So that's the other thing that I wanted to bring to your attention. Now, just about the sequence of إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. Why is Nasrullah first and Fatḥ second? What are some benefits of it? The first thing is that the help of Allah is the only reason you get victory. The help of Allah is the only reason you get victory. And the help of Allah is something you can see and something you can't see. Sometimes the help of Allah comes in battle. Sometimes the help of Allah comes by means of giving sakina to the believers when they're supposed to sign a treaty, which looks bad, but it's still the help of that. That's also part of the help of Allah. So the help of Allah has to come first, and as a consequence, you get victory. Some have understood this, wow, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ wa الْفَتْحِ, the wa in between, as عَطَفْ bayan. What that would mean is, when the help of Allah came, i.e., you know, in English we say i.e., that is to say, the victory. In other words, there's no difference between the help of Allah and the victory. When the help of Allah comes, that can only mean victory. So Allah is teaching us that there's no difference between the two things. Now just a small historical comment. When Mecca is conquered, first of all, it's the only magnificent conquest of its kind which does not lead to bloodshed and violence. Any people being overcome by another people leads to bloodshed and violence, but there is none. Handful of skirmishes here and there, but overall, there's no bloodshed. Second of all, it is the only incident of its kind where the military doesn't take advantage of its victory and goes and loots homes and executes and nothing. Actually, the public address is لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. There's no harm that will fall upon you today. These are the words of Yusuf alayhi salam when he overpowered his brothers. And these were the words used by the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. There are no parades. There are no dancing in the streets and waving the flag or the tank rolling by. And you know, there's no footage of that. There's nothing. The only celebration that's being made is the worship of Allah. That's the only celebration being made. Because you know, when any other army wins, they give credit to themselves and their nation. When the believers win, who do they give credit to? They give credit to Allah. This is not the time to celebrate, this is the time to thank Allah. Even the messenger enters in a state of sajda, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the first thing they do is clean up Allah's house. Subhanallah. It's a unique victory in the history of the world. It's a unique conquest. We haven't seen any conquest like this in the history of the world. Subhanallah. Just some brief commentary from the Mufassirun. إِذَا جَاءَكَ يَا مُحَمَّدُ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَنْ عَادَكَ. In explaining the tafsir, some Mufassirun said, when this victory came to you, O Muhammad, this victory, this help from Allah, against those who were enemies to you, وَهُمْ قُرَيْشٍ, and of course they were the Quraysh, وَالْفَتْحُ فَتْحْ مَكَّةٍ, and the fatḥ, the opening, refers to the conquest of Mecca, نَصَرَهُ عَلَى مَنْ قَاتَلَهُ مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ, that he aided him against those who fought him out of the kuffar, وَهُوَ فَتْحُ سَائِرِ الْبِلَادِ. And this victory includes the conquest of all lands. Meaning this fatḥ didn't just stop at Mecca. Allah didn't say, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحُ مَكَّةِ. He didn't say that. He said, وَالْفَتْحُ, and victory, and opening. You know what the benefit of that is? That it is not limited to the conquest of Mecca. It goes on. And the help of Allah goes on. And it expands and it expands and it expands. And very soon the deen of Islam and the flag of Islam isn't even limited to the Arab world. It's expanded even beyond that. And that's part of the fatḥ that Allah initiated, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we come to the second ayah. وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. The first word in this ayah is رَأَيْتَ. And you saw, or you will see, depending on which opinion we take that was mentioned in the first part. You know, a couple of surahs ago, Allah said, "Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar." We've guaranteed you the abundant good, the ultimate gift, the greatest good. Part of that good to the messenger that I mentioned earlier on today is that the messenger is extremely concerned, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the people will not believe. So before his life is over, his worldly life is over, Allah gives him a gift. You will get to see people entering into the religion with your own eyes. Wara'ayta is for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's a continuation of the second person that's been going on in all of these surahs. In all of these surahs, one way or another, Allah is talking to His Messenger. Even in the previous surah, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ قُلْ, right? Say, it's directly addressing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By the way, what time is the Isha prayer here? 9:30? Okay, okay. Let's move on, inshallah. So, the Messenger alayhi wa sallam is so worried that people won't believe. They will not believe. فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ. It regards to specifically the Christians, but other places, even other people. Are you going to kill yourself in grief because of the consequences of them not believing? إِلَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا. If they don't come to believe, and Allah gives him a gift, you will watch them believe with your own eyes. You will watch them come into Islam with your own eyes. So رَأَيْتَ is a gift from Allah. Because you know, even without رَأَيْتَ, the ayah is complete. وَكَانَ النَّاسِ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ. فَسَيَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ. They will enter into Allah's religion. The ayah is complete, the message is complete. But Allah adds a gift to His Messenger in the word رَأَيْتَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So رَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ. Now, And by the way, this is also part of fatarda. You know, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Until you are pleased. And when the messenger sees that, he is finally pleased. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then a comment about the word nas. And nas min al-arab wa ghayruhum. The nas, it, you know, of course, refers to the Arabs and other. وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ, you saw the people entering into the religion. The word people I'm referring to. وَأَرَادَ بِالنَّاسِ, Maqatil says and Ikrimah say, أَرَادَ بِالنَّاسِ أَهْلُ الْيَمَنِ, that majority, you know, of the nas that is referring to in this surah is the people of Yemen. وَذَلِكَ لِأَنَّهُ وَرَدَ مِنَ الْيَمَنِ سَبْعُ مِئَةِ إِنسَانِ مُؤْمِنِينَ. That is because 700 people at the same time became believers that came from Yemen. Other narrations tell us 40 came at a time, 80 came at a time, 100 came at a time from all other lands. And they would take shahada, they would listen to the message of Islam for a few days, they would spend some time with the messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would spend, and then they would go back, and the entire tribe, the entire village, the entire extended family would accept Islam. But Allah Azza wa Jal, here he used the word afwaj also, which is interesting, because you know, if you say fawjan in multitudes, afwajan fawjan ba'da fawjan. Before this, people used to accept Islam individual, ahadan ba'da ahadin, one after another. You know, fardan ba'da fardin, one person after another person. But now it's group after another group, after another group, after another group. So it's not one at a time, it's groups at a time, and that's captured inside the word afwaj. Now, previous surah mentioned kafirun. This surah says nas. There's a contrast. And this contrast has to be respected and understood. In the Quran, we should not oversimplify things. We should not look at things and brush over them like reading a newspaper. You see, the Quran, when Allah Azza wa Jal talked about the kafirun in the previous surah, this is not everyone who is not Muslim. These are a very specific brand of kufar which the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was specifically commanded to address, because they had refused to accept the religion, and so much so that they would not accept his religion, and they will never let go of their own. And it had become very clear, and so clear that it had to be said twice, وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدْ, had to be said twice. And at this point, the doors to da'wah are closed. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ. In other words, you're going to stay in your deen and I'm going to stay in mine. But this surah says, you know, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ. People are entering into the deen of Allah, which means these are not the same kuffar as the previous surah. Those were kuffar that were bent and they were going to remain in kuffar, and Allah knew that. Why am I making this point? Because an-nas, the people around you, don't oversimplify them as simply kuffar. Kafir is a very strong term in the Quran. It's used for the adamant refuser of Islam. Either it's used for that, the one who's heard the message of Islam, understood it, and then rejects it, because one of the core meaning of kafir is the one who rejects. The other meaning of kafir in the Quran is the one who picks up arms against believers. The one who fights a believer is also called kafir. There are two implications in the Quran of kafir. Now, to oversimplify and say, you know, I was having lunch with my kafir neighbor and he said, you know, It's not a healthy attitude. It's not a healthy attitude. And you know, let me tell you why not it's not a healthy attitude. Allah said about the kafir, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. There is no doubt about it, those who have done kufr, whether you, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you warn them or you don't warn them, they will not believe. Allah tells us that the kuffar are so stuck that even if the best da'i on the face of this earth, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was trying to warn them, or he didn't even bother, it wouldn't make a difference, they will not come to iman. Is this all people? Doesn't make any sense to accept that as all people. It doesn't make any sense. It's a gross oversimplification. You know, for fiqh reasons, and for other, in other discourse, maybe you can use the word kafir loosely. But when it comes to Quranic studies, you have to be very careful. The word has a very strong particular connotation and cannot be oversimplified. And if you do, it leads to very serious misunderstandings and misgivings about the religion. Because if that was true, nobody would ever accept Islam. Because Allah said they're not going to believe. There would be no point of da'wah. That would be done. So the word, the kuffar are there, but then in this surah, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ. People are entering into the religion. And Allah left the word people open. So much so that even people in Makkah, Makkah is the city where the messenger spent 10 years. Is it possible still, maybe somebody, you know, not everybody fought the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. Some guy is running his grocery store on the side, he doesn't care what's going on over there, he just minds his own business, never heard the message. Maybe somebody came to him one time, he didn't take it seriously, Right? But after Makkah is conquered in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah tells us, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ any of the believers, or rather any of the mushrikun, come to you at Makkah being conquered. Man, this is the 20 years now have gone by. If still any of the mushrikun come to you, and they want to, you know, they want to spend some time learning about Islam, give him permission until he gets to hear Allah's word. ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَا Then go, let him go to a safe place and think about it for himself. SubhanAllah. And even then he didn't use kafirin. He said, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ They're doing shirk, but kafir is something other than mushrik. They're two different things. The people around you may be doing shirk. They may be mushrik. But calling them kafir is something else. It's something far more serious. So I hope that point gets across to all of us, inshallah ta'ala. Now, some really interesting and unique commentary. I found it fascinating, actually, that some of our mufassirun had said about this ayah. فَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنِ الدِّينِ الْحَقِّ وَبَقِيَ عَلَى الْكُفْرِ فَكَأَنَّهُ لَيْسَ بِإِنسَانِ The ayah is saying that the people, you know, an-nas, the Arabic word nas, is associated with the word insan. And insan, by definition, is the one who possesses intellect, as opposed to hayawan, as opposed to the dawab, the beast, the animal. So the ayah says basically that the people entered the religion of Islam, the deen of Allah. So the mufassirun are saying, it is as though Allah is saying that those who didn't enter the religion of Islam aren't human. They're a bunch of animals. Because if you were, you know, in Punjabi say, bande da putar, right? If you were insan, then you entered Islam. But after all of this, you still remained on kufr, then you shouldn't even be called part of nas. You shouldn't even be called people. And فَهَذَا مَا أَرَادْ عِنْدَمَا قَالْ أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلْ Those people are like cattle, they're even worse than animals. They're even worse. Right? SubhanAllah. So the word nas here being anybody who still has humanity left, at this point they accepted Islam. فَكَيْفَ اسْتَحَقُوا هَذَا الْمَدْحَ الْعَظِيمِ This is the other important thing. These people just entered Islam. They weren't Sahaba, they didn't fight battles, they just came into Islam. So the question asked is, how did they deserve such a huge compliment from Allah? وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ Allah mentioned His nasr, and then He mentioned these people. Just the fact that these people are mentioned is a huge honor. It's a huge honor. So the question was asked, unlike the Sahaba who fought and made hijrah and spent in the path of Allah, these people didn't make any sacrifice. So how come Allah is giving them such a huge compliment and making them so honored that He mentioned them in the Surah of Victory? فَقُلْنَا هَذَا فِيهِ إِشَارَةٌ إِلَى سِعَةِ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ In this, is a hint, it's a clue as to the vastness of Allah's mercy. فَإِنَّ الْعَبْدِ بَعْدَ أَنْ أَتَى بِالْكُفْرِ وَالْمَعْصِيَةِ طُولَ عُمْرِهِ فَإِذَا أَتَى بِالْإِيمَانِ فِي آخِرِ عُمْرِهِ يُقْبِلُ إِيمَانَهُ SubhanAllah. The slave of Allah can live his entire life in disobedience, live his entire life in kufr, even live his entire, living in kufr is bad enough, live his entire life opposing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I mean, you can't think of a higher crime. But even after all of that, if he accepts Iman, Allah takes it like, oh, the whole thing is clean slate. Everything's gone. There's nothing bad about it. SubhanAllah. And so Allah even comes, this is alluding to the great mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. Then they entered, very interesting that Allah said this, very powerful too, and something to carefully think about. Allah didn't say they came to believe. فَسَيُؤْمِنُونَ أَوْ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ No. أَوْ بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ No. يَدْخُلُونَ They entered, they came entering into the religion of Allah, into the deen of Allah. Now, there's a difference, this is basically what ulama comment is, فَأَسْلَمُوا They accepted Islam. But accepting Islam is not the same as having what? Iman. The Sahaba have tested and proven their Iman. But these people have accepted Islam, they're coming in multitudes. The entire family is accepting Islam, some cousins like, what you guys doing? We're converting. Alright, let me come too. So they're jumping in, multitudes. Even Allah says, afwajan. You know, fardan, if you come individually, you thought about it yourself. You looked at the evidences yourself. You discussed it yourself. But if you come as a group, did everybody in the group think about it? No, not necessarily. You just came in, hey, everybody, we're accepting Islam. And that's how it worked back in the day. We're accepting Islam. All right, let's go. How do we do that? La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, everybody's done. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they came in, not necessarily by istidlal. But bit taqleed, like some Sahaba even commented, just entered quickly into Islam. So Allah did not make a comment about the state of their hearts. And this is important. This is very important. That Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the outward victory of Islam. Because having iman is inside, but Islam is what? It's outside. And this surah, half of it is about what's going on the outside. But the other half of it, the rest of it, what we're going to see, is about what's going on inside. فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. Istighfar, hamd, tasbih, tawbah. Where are those things happening? They're happening inside. So this surah is giving us two pictures, two sides of the same coin. SubhanAllah, the eloquence of this surah. Now we're going to read something in regards to this that is narrated by Al-Hasan. I'll just read the Arabic and translate for you. لما فتح رسول الله مكة أقبلت العرب بعضها على بعض. That when the Messenger والسلام, was given victory of Mecca, the Arabs, groups after others, started accepting Islam. فقالوا. So they said, إذا ظفر بأهل الحرم وجب أن يكون على الحق. This is important. The Arabs would say, all these neighboring tribes would say, well, if he was given victory over the Haram, it's mandatory that he must be the messenger. Their mentality was, if he has been able to conquer Mecca, that must mean that he's right. Because God, Allah would not allow anyone to conquer Mecca except if they are right. Why not? Because they have seen what before? وَقَدْ كَانَ أَجَارَهُمْ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. When the army of the elephants came, did Allah let them come? No, Allah didn't let the army of elephants come, but Allah let Muhammad come, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which means Muhammad must be right. So their logic was that because he won, because he was given victory, that's why we're accepting Islam. This is narrated by Hasan radiallahu anhu. وَكُلَّ مَنْ أَرَادَهُمْ بِسُوءٍ. And everyone who intended harm against Quraysh has always been defeated. ثُمَّ أَخَذُوا يَدْخُلُونَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ أَفْوَاجًا مِنْ غَيْرِ قِتَالٍ. And after they realized this, they started entering groups after groups after groups into Islam without putting up a single fight, because they saw unanimously the value of the Kaaba. And so since Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has become the custodian of the Kaaba, they accepted his religion. This also meant, some ulama have commented about this, saying that this is not a healthy attitude. It's great that they said, oh, he's taken care of the Kaaba, he must be right. But he's not right because he's got victory over the Kaaba. He's been right before he got victory over the Kaaba too. So their rationale was something based on their own culture and tradition. Which further justifies why Allah didn't just call it iman. At this time, it's only what still? It's still Islam. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. Iman has not yet entered into your hearts yet. So, this is important because the Messenger gave, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a prediction. عن جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنه أنه بكى ذات يوم. He was crying. جابر بن عبد الله was crying one day. فقيل له. It was said to him. ما يبكيك. What is making you cry? فقال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then he said, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, دَخَلَ النَّاسِ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. People have entered into the religion of Allah in multitude after multitude. وَسَيَخْرُجُونَ مِنْهُ أَفْوَاجًا. And they will leave it also in multitudes. What the Messenger is referring to is people like Musaylaba bin al-Kadhab. He's referring to these movements of these Murtaddeen that took many with them. These guys came into Islam without thinking much about it, and they left without thinking much about it. So this is what happens. When you get into something without coming in seriously, then you don't realize what it takes to stick to it. And this is why it is so important for all Muslims to realize the difference between Islam handed down generation after generation, just as a family thing, and Islam handed down as a conviction that burns in your heart. If Islam makes its way into your heart, then there's no way it's coming out. There's no way. But if Islam was just handed down to you one generation after another, and you never really cared for it, and it wasn't given to you in a way that penetrates into your heart, you're just Muslim because your parents are Muslim. You're just praying because your parents prayed one time. That's it. That's the only Islam you have. Then you know what Allah says about that kind of people? He says, وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُورِثُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ لَفِي شَكِّ مِنْهُ مُرِيبٍ. Those who were given the book in inheritance after them. So they were believers, and after them, they were people who inherited. They just got it as viratha. Urithul kitab min ba'dihim. Lafi shak. Then they are in doubt about it. They're in doubt about minhu murib. That puts others in doubt too. They're in doubt about their religion. This is why I say that we should never take the Islam of our children for granted. Never. We should never take the Islam of our kids for granted. You know, I was traveling, I was in Nevada, and I met a 93-year-old guy. He was a Eastern European fellow. He was with his wife, they were at a Quran conference. And you know, white couple, they clearly didn't look like they belonged. They were looking around, kind of tourists, you know. So I sat next to them and started talking to them. So he says, "Assalamu alaikum." I was like, "Walaikum salam. Where are you folks from?" He goes, "We're from Ohio." It's like, "Wow, you're a long way from Ohio." "Yeah, we've been doing a road trip." So we start talking. You know what he tells me? He was doing his white, typical white family living in Ohio. He was doing a study of his family tree. He's looking up his ancestry. You know what he found out? His great-great-great-grandfather was Syrian. And he was Muslim. So because of that, he starts looking into Islam. Because his great-great-grand, somebody had moved to Europe, and they lost their religion after generations, and he was raised, you know, Christian Orthodox, Catholic, Greek Orthodox. So he starts looking into Islam and accepts Islam, and he says, "I have two reasons. I want to revive the legacy of my father," and it's pretty clearly the truth. But he didn't take, you know, you can't take your previous generations for granted. There were people that were Muslim, and never thought that one day their children will be Christian or Jews or atheist or agnostic or whatever, self-proclaimed atheist. They never imagined that would be the case. But that did happen over time. That did, and it happens to other religions. Don't think it doesn't happen to us. There are Catholic churches in New York City, you know, that are nightclubs now. They used to be Catholic churches. They're turned into nightclubs because there's nobody filling those churches. And that's the Christian community. They're in much more numbers. And they weren't able to keep their future generations. We have to be serious about this stuff. Entering into the deen casually, the messenger warns, they came easily, they came in multitudes, they left in multitudes. We have to come in with conviction and we have to stick to it, inshallah ta'ala. Nonetheless, a great victory of Islam, Allah Azza wa Jal talks about in this surah. May Allah Azza wa Jal protect us from that. Ash-Shawkani rahimahullah, after this narration, he said, "Na'udhu billahi min as-salb ba'd al-ata." We seek Allah's refuge from Him taking it away after He's given it to us, this deen. So finally, the last ayah, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. I will discuss this ayah in two ways. One, I will talk about this ayah cut off from what has come before, and at the end, inshallah, I'll tie it together because that's a heavy lesson. Probably I'll have to take time after Aisha from you if that's okay with everybody, inshallah. First things first, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. A few things in this ayah, then declare the perfection of your master by doing praise of him and seek his forgiveness. He has always been one to accept repentance, no doubt. The first comment we make about the remarkable language of this ayah is أَخَّرَ ذِكْرَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ عَنِ التَّسْبِيحِ وَالتَّحْمِيدِ. Allah mentioned istighfar at the end. He mentioned tasbih first, فَسَبِّحْ. Then he mentioned hamd, بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ. Then he mentioned istighfar, وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. So istighfar is at the end. In it, there's a great lesson to learn for those who want to make istighfar. If you want to ask Allah for forgiveness, that is something you want. Before you ask Allah for what you want, you give Him first what He deserves. You do hamd first, you do tasbih first. Then you ask Allah for what you want. This is the way of getting dua accepted. Allah is teaching us that in the sequence of the ayah. Istighfar could have been first, but istighfar is for you. Hamd is for Allah. Hamd is for Allah, subhanAllah. So فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. Then إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. So anyhow, so that's the first thing. The second is, this ayah is a tafsir of another ayah. Allah Azza wa Jal had told His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَاعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. Enslave yourself to your master until the conviction, the final, the death basically comes. Enslave yourself. What is the means to do ibadah? فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ. These are the two components of ibadah. On the one hand, it is declaring Allah's perfection. On the other, it is acknowledging your own fault. This is the two parts of ibadah. In any ibadah, we're going to do one of two things. Either we'll be praising Allah, or we'll be acknowledging our mistakes. Praising Allah is covered in سَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ. Acknowledging our mistakes is covered in what? وَاسْتَغْفِرُهُ. In the two, all of ibadah is covered. It basically, all of ibadah is one of these two things. فاللفظ يفيد التنزيه في الذات والصفات والأفعال والقول. The word sabbih, which means to declare perfection, comes from sabaha, to swim, to float. When you put something in water and it floats. Clouds, you know, they also do tasbih in the sense that they float in the air. Birds can be said to have been doing tasbih if they're gliding. The word tasbih used for Allah implies say about Allah what declares His perfection and maintain that perfection. Don't let it come down. Maintain the perfection of Allah. That is what tasbih means. But tasbih, the word includes declaring Him free from fault in terms of His self, His attributes, the things He says, and the things that He does. فِي الْأَفْعَالِ وَالْأَقْوَالِ In everything. Don't say anything inappropriate about Allah. Don't say anything inappropriate about the attributes of Allah. This is the kind of thing, tasbih is what Bani Israel, some members of Bani Israel failed in. They said about Allah, يَدُ maghlula. Allah's hands are tied. They said about Allah Azza wa Jal, إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَاءُ Allah is in need, we don't need. We're free of need, ma'ad Allah. They said those things about Allah Azza wa Jal, negating His tasbih. But Allah Azza wa Jal tells us to maintain, and He tells His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to maintain His perfection. Some have said, أَنَّ الْمُرَادِ بِالتَّسْبِيحِ الصَّلَاةِ That in this surah, when Allah commands His Messenger to declare Allah's perfection, what He means by that is to make salah. لِأَنَّ هَذَا اللَّفْظ وارد في القرآن بمعنى الصلاة because this wording has come in the Quran in the meaning of salah where فسبحان الله حين تمسون وحين تصبحون declare Allah's perfection in the evenings and also in the mornings what does that mean عشاء prayer فجر prayer also Allah says فسبح بحمد ربك قبل طلوع الشمس declare the perfection of your master before the sun comes up what is that referring to The Fajr prayer. So this wording may directly be a reference to Salah. What we're learning then is the best way to declare Allah's perfection and the best way to praise Him and the best way to ask Him for forgiveness is what? Is Salah. That's what we're learning because of that. روت عائشة كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بعد نزول هذه السورة يكثر أن يقول It is narrated by Aisha رضي الله عنها that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the surah came down, he used to make a lot of this dhikr. Which dhikr? Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. He used to start doing this a lot more when this surah came down. Because the surah said, make tasbih, make istighfar. So he started doing lots more of it. وَقَالَتْ أَيْضًا كَانَ الرَّسُولُ يَقُولْ كَثِيرًا فِي رُكُوعِهِ That he used to do a lot of this in his ruku' especially. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik Allahumma ghfir li. So he added that in his ruku'. وَعَنْهَا أَيْضًا كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمُ فِي آخِرِ أَمْرِهِ لَا يَقُومُ وَلَا يَقْعُدُ وَلَا يَذْهَبُ وَلَا يَجِي إِلَّا قَالَ That he would not stand or sit or go or come anywhere except that he would say Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. He would constantly say Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. فَقُلْتُ So I said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنَّكَ تُكَثِّرْ مِنْ قَوْلَةِ سُبْحَانِ اللَّهِ وَبِحَمْدِهِ You are increasing a lot of this dhikr. You're saying it all the time. That's what she said, رضي الله عنها. So he says, قَالَ إِنِّي أُمِرْتُ بِهَا I was commanded to do so. وَقَرَأَ And he recited, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ So he recited this surah because he says, I make a lot of this dhikr, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, all the time because he says, I was told to do so by Allah in this surah. وعن ابن مسعود ابن مسعود narrates لما نزلت هذه السورة كان عليه السلام يكثر أن يقول and he also narrates that he used to say a lot of what سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اللهم اغفر لي إنك أنت التواب الغفور this is the dhikr narrated by ابن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنهما in regards to this ayah finally before we take a break for the salah inshallah ta'ala tying this ayah to a couple of other things just tying it to what came before a little bit now The first thing to note here is Allah Azza wa Jal gave victory and cleansed the house of Allah. He had the house of Allah cleansed and he had Makkah purified. So finally, أَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ That the masajid belonged to Allah and of course, of all the masajid, the one that belongs most to Allah, the house of Allah built. That is the basis for which all the other masajid are built are now only for Allah. Now that that house is pure, now is the best time to make tasbih. Now is the best time to make tasbih. That's the first thing. Then Allah says, وَلَا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ In another place in the Quran, He says, وَلَا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ And for sure, the remembrance of Allah is greater. What we're learning is, the victory that Allah gave is great. People entering into the religion is great. But the remembrance of Allah is still greater. At the end of all of this, the greatest thing is, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُ SubhanAllah. So that is even greater than the rest. Now, we're going to get a little bit deeper into the study of فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ. But I don't want to break that discussion, so I'll give you an early break for the Isha prayer and tie this up at the end, inshallah, because we have to talk a lot about the relationship between سَبِّحْ and بِحَمْدِ, the two words, how they come together in the Qur'an, and what meanings and what benefits it has for us, inshallah ta'ala. So at this, we'll take a break. بَارَكَ اللَّهُ لِي وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقُرْآنِ الْحَكِيمِ وَنَفَعْنِي وَإِيَّاكُمْ بِالْآيَاتِ وَالذِّكْرِ الْحَكِيمِ. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Inshallah, in this final session on this surah, what we're going to start with is some qualities of the phrase فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ, just that part of it, and some very powerful benefits that come from it. First, understand the difference between hamd and tasbih, basically. The word sabbih comes from the word tasbih. Tasbih is to declare Allah's perfection, to keep it simple in your minds. Tasbih, the purpose of it is to declare Allah's perfection, to declare Him above and beyond any flaws. Hamd in the Arabic language is two things: is to declare Allah's gratitude to Allah, and appreciation of Allah. So praise and gratitude combined. When we praise and show thanks to Allah, that's hamd. When we declare His perfection, it is tasbih. So those two things. Now Allah says, "Fasabbih bihamdi." So He combined tasbih with hamd, and He combined it with the letter ba, bihamdi. So what is the meaning come out to be? The first of them. أي قل سبحان الله والحمد لله متعجبا مما أراك من عجيب أنعامه أي إجمع بينهما. It means, say subhanallah walhamdulillah. You know how we say in the phrase subhanallah walhamdulillah, we say that we say the perfection of Allah and we say the hamd of Allah. So he's saying sabbih bihamdi, declare the perfection along with saying the hamd of Allah. So say both of them together. This is used in Arabic, for example, شربت الماء باللبن. I drink water with milk. What that means is I drank water and milk. So they can use ba to do both. So that's one meaning of it, meaning say subhanallah walhamdulillah. Thaniyan, إِذَا حَمِدْتَ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ سَبَّحْتَهُ. If you do hamd of Allah, it actually already means that you've declared His perfection. In other words, the meaning would be declare Allah's perfection, that is to do hamd of Allah. In other words, doing hamd of Allah means you're already declaring Allah's perfection. How so? لِأَنَّ التَّسْبِيحْ دَاخِلٌ فِي الْحَمْدِ. Because tasbih, declaring Allah's perfection, is included in showing Allah praise and gratitude. لِأَنَّ الثَّنَاءَ عَلَيْهِ وَالشُّكْرُ لَهُ لَا بُدْ وَأَنْ يَتَضَمَّنْ تَنْزِيهَ عَنِ النَّقَائِسِ. It's only, you know, when you praise someone and you show him gratitude, by praising Allah and by thanking Him, we've already declared that He has no flaws. And you only praise something that does, someone or something that doesn't have flaws to begin with. So the second meaning becomes, declare the perfection of Allah by means of doing His hamd. That's the way you declare perfection of Allah, because it's one and the same thing. Then the third is أن تكون هذه الباء هي التي في قولك فعلت هذا بفضل الله. This is important again. That ba could be in the meaning of by means of, or actually because of. So what he's saying then is that declare Allah's perfection because all praise and gratitude belong to Allah. Because Allah is worthy of hamd, that should be enough reason for you to say subhanallah. So subhanallah becomes the reason for it becomes alhamdulillah. Because that is a fact, that's a reality. That praise and gratitude belong to Allah, and that should make you declare His perfection. أَنْ يَكُونَ حَالًا أَيْ سَبِّحْ حَامِدًا. Means it could be an adverbial phrase. What that means simply is, when you declare Allah's perfection, have an attitude of someone who appreciates the favors of Allah. So have the attitude of someone who is appreciative when you say subhanallah. So bihamdi rabbi could be about the attitude of the one saying it. So don't just say the words, have the attitude of someone who truly appreciates Allah and is grateful to Him. And تكون الباء صلة زائدة ويكون التقدير سبح حمد ربك. This is the final and most important, in my opinion at least, wallahu a'lam, that the final meaning is the ba could be za'id. What that simply means is, in practical English, declare Allah's perfection. Declare Allah's perfection, but in addition, perfect the way you do hamd of Allah. So tasbih, sabbih means to perfect. Perfect the way in which you do hamd. So better and better and better your salah. Better and better and better your dhikr of Allah. So that's the final implication of Sabbih bihamdi. And then finally, Rabbik. Rabbik, your master, of course. The ka referring to the messenger. And the word Rabb we've discussed many times before. Al-Malik, wal-Sayyid, wal-Murabbi, wal-Mun'im, wal-Qayyim. All these meanings. The one who's in charge and control. The one who gives gifts. And the word Rabb here is important because, you know, when you are victorious, because the messenger has been given victory. But if anybody else is given victory, they think of themselves in charge. But he's being told immediately, now that you have victory, who's in charge? Ya Rabb, remember him, subhanAllah, it's perfectly mentioned here. Then, innahu kana tawwaba. Just some benefits of tawwab, and we'll tie the whole surah together, inshallah. Allah says the word kana, innahu kana tawwab. He didn't say innahu tawwab, he says innahu kana tawwab. And he mentions it in the past tense. A rough translation will be, it is only he that is no doubt, it is he who has been accepting of repentance. He has been continually accepting of repentance. Tawwab is different from ta'ib in Arabic. Tawwab means someone who comes back over and over and over again. Meaning he turns back to you and accepts your tawbah, turns back again and accepts your tawbah, turns back again and accepts your tawbah. But he mentions not of this attribute in the present, but alludes to it in the past. He has always been this way. So what's the benefit of alluding to it in the past? Especially because when we think of tawbah, we think of something that should happen in the future. Okay, he accepted tawbah in the past, but we're actually hoping he accepts the one I'm making now in the future, right? So what's the benefit of mentioning it in the past? The first is that haven't you seen what I've done in the past? As the ulama comment about this ayah. Didn't you see I accepted the tawbah of Bani Israel after they did shirk with me? If I can accept their tawbah, then you are the messenger of Allah. Your tawbah is far more acceptable. So I have been accepting of far bigger, worse criminals, and when they make tawbah, so your tawbah is clearly acceptable. And by the way, in the context of this surah, people entered into the deen of Islam, right? They entered into the deen of Allah. وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ. Accepting Islam is a kind of tawbah. Accepting Islam is tawbah from shirk, it's tawbah from kufr, it's tawbah from what you were in, from jahiliyyah, from darkness. And I have accepted all these people's tawbah, so I have been that way and my doors are still open. So that's the one benefit of kana. The other is it's a show of love to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's being asked to make istighfar and Allah is saying, by the way, I have already accepted your tawbah. Even before you make istighfar, I have already been kana tawwaban. I've already had your tawbah accepted. You should still make istighfar. In other words, this is a gift given to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The sha'ir, the poet says, لَقَدْ أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ فِي مَا مَضَى كَذَلِكَ يُحْسِن فِي مَا بَقَى. In other words, Allah has already excelled in what already happened. Then we can only expect the same from him in what remains in the future. Now we come to the last and probably, in my opinion, the most important part of this dars, of this surah. What ties the surah together? How these two messages come together. The first message of the surah was the victory of Islam. The second message of the surah is tasbih and hamd and istighfar, specifically directed to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's look at these connections bit by bit. I have seven things to share with you. The first of them, at-tasbih huwa at-tathir. Tasbih is a means of purification. Tasbih is purification. Now that the house of Allah has been purified of idols, now it is the time to purify the hearts as well. This is the perfect time to purify the hearts as well. So one is the purification happening on the outside, the other is a call for purification of what is inside. The fa makes it very clear, the fa in the ayah, fa sabbih bihamdi, fa sababiyya. In other words, because the things that have happened, the victories that have come, because of them you should make tasbih, so the two have been connected. Now, I was thinking when victory comes, the words I was expecting was fashkur, be grateful. You know, when something good happens, you thank Allah. But Allah said, make tasbih, declare his hamd, and do istighfar. Three things. And he said it specifically to his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I told you before, this commandment was given to the messenger before, wa'bud rabbak hatta ya'tiyaka al-yaqeen, right? Enslave yourself to your master until conviction comes to you, until death comes to you. The messenger specifically is being told to busy himself in these things. And ulama comment, to make himself busy in these things so that he can continually make dua for his ummah. So فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ لِأُمَّتِكَ لَكْ وَلِأُمَّتِكَ. So for yourself and for your ummah. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Make istighfar for the believers. Ask Allah to forgive them. Then, you know, normally in any other scenario, I mentioned this in passing before, in any other scenario, victory is the time of great arrogance. Victory is the time to say, we did it. We did it. We accomplished it. Get time to give credit to yourself. People will come and congratulate you. In other words, victory is the time when egos are at their highest. And Allah is teaching us, just because you've destroyed idols on the outside, don't forget there's a worse idol inside your heart, and that is arrogance. And this is the time when that idol can be born. So kill that idol by declaring the perfection of Allah and asking istighfar of Him. If that thought even came in your head that we won, we got Him, we're on top, we're number one. If that attitude even came in your heart, get rid of it. Get rid of it, because that those idols you can see, this is a more dangerous idol. You can't even see it, but it's there. It's a form of shirk. It is a form of shirk. Arrogance is a huge thing, you know. So this is the other shirk that's being destroyed. If the external means of shirk are being destroyed, make sure the internal means of shirk are also destroyed. SubhanAllah, he's been using the messenger as a teacher, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then, the next thing is, فَإِذَا, this is very beautiful. You know, Allah told His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ وَإِلَى رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ. فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ, a messenger has to have two missions. He has two missions. He has to communicate with Allah and he has to communicate with the people. He's got to do two things. And he wants to he communicates with Allah, then he communicates with the people. Which you would think he would rather do? If you have the option between communicating with Allah as a messenger, communicating with Allah or communicating with the people, definitely with Allah Azza wa Jal. Actually, at the time of his parting, at the time of death, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma rafiqul a'la, he called on Allah as the highest friend, the greatest friend. You know, at the time of death, everybody's thinking, I'm going to miss my friends, I'm leaving everybody behind. And he's thinking, no, I'm finally going to see my friend. SubhanAllah. He's got a connection somewhere else. And you know, the way my teacher explained it to me, he compared it to how, you know, Allah Azza wa Jal, you know, the same scenario happened with Musa alayhi salam. He was supposed to speak to Allah, he got to speak to Allah, but then Allah told him, no, go talk to Fir'aun. Which one would he rather talk to? Allah Azza wa Jal, clearly. But now, why do you have to go talk to the people? Because your mission is not done. The mission is not done. The messengers are on a mission. And that mission can be very tough. The people will insult them, humiliate them, call them names. Now think about that. We hear this all the time, but we don't think about it, you know? You and I, we come from respectable families. We're respectable people. You may have respectable jobs. You don't go in a place where people use foul language against you and curse you and your family. When you're respectable and somebody says something inappropriate to you, man, it ruins your whole day. Like if somebody cursed you out in a parking lot or something or called you a name, you would be stressed out the entire day. They didn't hit you with anything. They didn't injure you. But people of dignity, the most painful thing is an attack on one's dignity. And the most noble people, you know, and I've seen people like that. When they have, somebody said something inappropriate at work to them. Slightly inappropriate. Man, they don't want to eat lunch. They're all depressed. They're not talking. What happened? Oh, I don't want to talk about it, you know. They shrivel up. They shrivel up. The more noble you are, and the more soft-hearted you are, the more it hurts when somebody uses foul language against you. Now, on the other hand, if you're not a dignified person, and you're around people who use filthy language all the time, and somebody cusses you out, you're like, eh, and you cuss them back out, you know. You know, it doesn't make a difference to you. Now think about these messengers. These are the most noble of people. They're the most respectable people. They have the cleanest tongues. And what kind of language do they get to hear from people against them when they give this message? The kind of filthy language, the ridicule, the humiliation, the cursing that they hear day in and day out. And then on top of that, attacks against their family, you know, constantly. You don't think it wears down on somebody's heart? You'd rather talk to them or talk to Allah? but Allah says, no, go talk to them. قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ, go rise and warn them. You know, we just heard about Nuh alayhi salam. I recited that on purpose. You know what happened when Nuh alayhi salam would go and make da'wah? إِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي أَذَانِهِمْ. They'd see him coming, you know what they would do? I don't want to hear it. Get lost. And then when he would get close to them, they would act like they're disgusted. وَاسْتَغْشَوْ ثِيَابَهُمْ. Get away! Disgusting. Imagine somebody acts like that towards you. Oh my God! Filthy, you know? They acted like that with Nuh alayhi salam. And he actually, and then he said, that's not even the worst part. وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا. And they were extremely arrogant towards me. He can't even put it in words, yet they were really arrogant towards me. The little things he did tell us, man, you can't even imagine somebody acting like that towards you. This is the conversation messengers have to engage in. And finally, in this surah, Allah tells His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, your mission is done. You're finished. now you get to do what you've been wanting to do all along. If you give the messenger the option, he would be making istighfar to Allah and hamd of Allah and tasbih of Allah all along. He would only be connected to Allah Azza wa Jalla, and Allah gives him that license. Now you go. Now we find, now it makes sense that the Sahaba say, as soon as the surah is revealed, what's the messenger doing always? Tasbih, he increases his salah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's constantly connected to Allah, because now he's got the right to. Allah has given him that license. He finds his joy in salah. He finds his peace in salah. He finds his peace and happiness in remembering Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is one thing I wanted to bring to your attention. The second and more sensitive thing that I wanted to bring to your attention in this dars, maybe I'll dedicate the next dars entirely to it, I don't know, but I'll at least introduce it now, because we can't move to the next surah until we get this point across. There are two extremes in the Muslim ummah in regards to the attitude we have towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the one extreme, there are people who love him so much. They love him so much that they'll even do shirk in love of him. They will say things that should only be said about Allah, and then they'll say them about the Messenger of Allah, and when you ask them, why are you saying that? And they'll say, out of love. This is one extreme. On the other extreme, however, there are Muslims, people who claim to be Muslims, who talk about Allah's Messenger that the way they just talk about any other historical figure. Muslims. And they'll say very casual things about the messengers. Yeah, you know, the messenger, yeah, it's just a hadith, or it's just, you know, it's not that important, or yeah, he gave us the Quran, but you know, we don't have to follow everything, or casually talking about the Messenger of Allah. Just like they're talking about anybody else. This is a high crime, by the way. If you think shirk is a crime, this is also a high crime. This is a very serious matter. And the truth lies somewhere in between. And very few people have a balanced attitude in their relationship to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I bring this up for a reason. In this surah, Allah didn't just ask the Messenger to make tasbih and to make hamd. He also asked him to make istighfar. And you and I know istighfar is made for what? What is istighfar made for? For sins. And Allah mentions himself as tawwab. Allah has always accepted tawbah. And tawbah is done for what? When somebody makes a mistake, they make tawbah and then istighfar. So then the question arises, what has the Messenger done, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that warrants the need for istighfar? I understand hamd and tasbih all the time. Then what is it that it warrants istighfar, and why is Allah saying he's going to accept tawbah? And by the way, the other surah of fath, this is إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. What's the other surah of fath? إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. There also, Allah Azza wa Jal said, لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ. So Allah may cover for you whatever of ma'ad, I don't want to translate. It scares me to translate. Whatever of your dhamb, I won't even translate, that you may have done and whatever may come in the future. I know common translations say sin. I don't like that word for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm scared to use that word for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What does it mean though, that Allah said He'll forgive the previous and the future? You know what, right? What does that mean? And what does it mean that Allah will accept istighfar? This is what we have to understand. Understand first of all, degrees. I want you to have an organized approach to understanding this problem. First of all, understand degrees. You know, there are different levels of people. There are different levels of people. There's someone who comes here for salah every day. And they are here even before the adhan. They're here before the adhan at Fajr. They're here before the adhan at Isha. And one day they get late. One day they come and they join the first rak'ah. Or they join the second rak'ah. They got late, they joined the second rak'ah. You think they feel good or feel bad? They feel very bad that day. Man, I missed it. I messed up. Then next to them is another person. And this person hasn't been to the masjid in 6 months. They live next door, but they haven't been here for 6 months. And they decide one day they're going to come to... They also join the second rak'ah. You think that guy feels good or feels bad? Man, this is... I did good today. People are at different levels. So for one, he's thinking, you know, this is sayyi'at al-abrar, hasanat, you know, the annas, really. The what the righteous people think of as a sin, the common person thinks of as a great accomplishment. This one is thinking, I messed up, astaghfirullah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa, how did I miss it? And that one is thinking, man, may Allah reward me, I did really good today. right? But for him it's a dhamb, for him it's a sin. Dhamb, by the way, it shouldn't be translated sin. Dhamb comes from the tail, the Arabic word dhanab, the tail of an animal. What the tail of an animal is, that which is, embarrasses it. Dhamb is something you do that embarrasses you. Now the same act is being done, but one is embarrassed by it, the other one's proud of it. You understand what I'm saying? When the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, his act that disappoints him is still greater than the best thing we'll ever do. There's difference in levels. At our level, what will be our greatest deed in our life would still probably be a dhamb for him. It'll still, he's still that high up. So we're down here, he's up there, he goes from up there to here, and this is a dhamb for him. Now, don't call that a sin. That would be a grave mistake to call that a sin. Now let me tell you what these dhunub are, just so you and I understand. Let me give you an example. Abdullah ibn Maktum comes to the Messenger, blind Sahabi, cousin of the wife of the Prophet ﷺ. He comes to him. Messenger of Allah ﷺ is talking to somebody else. He's talking to a leader of Quraysh. And he starts interrupting the conversation. He's blind, but he's not what? He's not deaf. Does he hear a conversation is going on? He hears it. He still interrupts it. So who's being rude? Who's not being appropriate? First and foremost. Second of all, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't tell him, stop, I'm talking to someone. What did he do? Do you know what he did? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he do? Abasa. You know what abasa means? In English they translate it as frowned. You know what it actually means? It doesn't. Frowning is this. This is frowning. You know what abasa is? Abasa is that the bulge on your forehead appears, but nothing else on your face is showing frustration. Just slight little bulge on your forehead. The Messenger is a little perplexed that he keeps interrupting the conversation. And he just turns slightly. He's not this. He just turns slightly. It's frustrating. And by the way, even if he turned, is he blind? Is Abdullah blind? Can he see it happen? So is he possibly offended? No. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam did nothing wrong. Nothing wrong. He didn't offend the Sahabi. Abbas. But Allah Azza wa Jal has set such a high standard for His Messenger that even that Allah said you shouldn't have done it. What is not a sin at all for any of us. It is not a sin at all. But for the Messenger, he has been placed on a much higher standard than we. So he comes and Allah Azza wa Jal comes on him for that. And by the way, Allah Azza wa Jal could have revealed the ayah. He could have revealed the ayah before it happened. Right? فَاسْتَمِعْ لَهُ. Listen to him carefully. No. Allah waited till he turned a little bit and then he revealed the ayah. You know why? So we learn something. You know what we learn from this ayah? We learn that the only one who can criticize the Messenger of Allah is who? Allah Himself. That's it. No one else can criticize the Messenger of Allah. Which is why I get scared to use words like sin. We can't use those kinds of words. What is he making istighfar for? That's the question here. You know, some captives at Badr, some kuffar get captured at Badr. Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Messenger says, what should we do with them? Umar ibn al-Khattab says, we should kill all of them. I got a better idea. Get their family members who are Muslim to kill them so we know where they stand. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq comes and says, no, actually we should get them to teach us to read and write. And if they do that, we should set them free. So you got two options, huh? You got the Umar option, you got the Abu Bakr option. You take a wild guess, which one did Rasulullah ﷺ take? He took the Abu Bakr option. Rahmatul lil alameen, it's got strategic benefits too. Their hearts will be softened to Islam, so many benefits. Nothing wrong with the decision. Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the ayah in Surah Muhammad, saying you should have gone the Umar opinion. Now Allah could have revealed the ayah before. Right? He could have revealed the ayah before, but He revealed it after. Now, did the Messenger disobey Allah, ma'adallah? No. Because he didn't do it after the ayah came, he did it before the ayah, and before the ayah, he made his decision based on the best knowledge that Allah had given him and the mercy that Allah had already put in his heart. Allah, the only one who could have known better, the only one who could have heard those two opinions and said, no, Umar's got the better opinion. The only one who could give that answer is who? Allah. And he did. And Allah did. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, and look at the love Allah shows His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The munafiq comes to him. The munafiq comes to him and says, I'm not going in the battle of Tabuk. I can't go. Because the women there are so pretty. On the way there are villages and the women are really pretty. And I'm a player, I can't help myself. So I can't go into battle. I mean, of all the lame excuses you're going to come up with to not to go into battle, right? And if this guy's coming up with such a lame excuse, it makes complete sense that he's probably going to be a useless or even a liability on the battlefield anyway. So the smart thing to do is what? Okay, you stay home. In Surah At-Tawbah, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, عَفَ اللَّهُ عَنْكَ. Allah has already forgiven you. لِمَا أَذِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Why did you give them permission? Now that decision that Allah's Messenger made, that was a strategic decision. It was a strategic decision. But it wasn't an act of disobedience. Even that decision was an act of worship. But then, now here's what I want you to remember from this conversation. The Messenger feels bad that Allah corrected. The Messenger thinks of that as a sin. Is it actually a sin? No. But the Messenger's level is so high that in his high standards, he thinks of it as a sin, so he feels the need to make istighfar. So Allah says, do what your heart has been telling you all along, make istighfar. And by the way, why does he feel bad? Because you know all of these decisions that the Prophet made, I call them strategic decisions. The purpose of them is eventually to get victory of this deen. Did Allah give the victory already? He did. In other words, even if there was strategically a mistake, ma'adallah, even the word mistake I'm scared to use, but whatever decision wasn't the best, if such a decision was made, it might hurt the mission. So you know what Allah said in Surah Al-Fath? He said, "Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina." We have given you a clear victory. Remember that from Hudaybiyah? What did he say after that? لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Whatever things you do that disappoint you, that you, every strategic move you made that you didn't like, or that I corrected, that you did in the past or you did in the future, is covered for, victory is guaranteed. وَيَنْصُرَكَ اللَّهُ نَصْرًا عَزِيزًا. That Allah will aid you with an authoritative aid. Don't worry about it. And that's the surah, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. So this is the, you know, takreem. لِتُعَزِّرُوهُ وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ. That you show honor to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why it makes my heart heavy when somebody says, which translation do you recommend? I usually go to Surah Al-Fath and see what they translated. Because you can't just take dhamb and just translate heart, you know, sin and move on. You can't do that. You can't do that. And Allah in this surah told him, make istighfar because that's what you love doing. And by the way, one of the most beloved deeds to Allah is what? Is istighfar. The sin or no sin, istighfar is beloved to Allah. That's why the Messenger does it. That's why the Messenger does it. And by the way, this is the final thing I will share with you in regards to this. The Messenger's mission is to do what Allah tells him. That's his mission. Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was building the Kaaba, before he even started building, Allah Azza wa Jal told him, he gave him a graduation certificate, إِنِّي جَعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. I am making you imam over all people. And you have already, I've already tested you. وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ. He completed, passed all the tests. Ibrahim A.S. is guaranteed that he is passed all the tests, and now he's commanded to build the house. And as they are building the house, he and Ismail A.S., you know what they said? They said, وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا. Part of their dua was, accept our tawbah. Tawbah from what? They're putting every brick together. But maybe one brick didn't place where Allah wants it to be. And I am afraid of that. So I make tawbah to Allah. They're putting Allah's house together and they're thinking maybe they made some mistakes. So that should require their tawbah. What's the difference between the tawbah of a prophet and the tawbah of a believer and a Muslim? SubhanAllah, there's a world of difference. We make tawbah for watching that movie or going yelling at the wife, or we make tawbah for missing salat because we overslept. We make tawbah for sins. They're called sayyi'at. Look, read the beginning of Surah Al-Fatih. You know what we'll find? You'll find when the messenger is mentioned, dhamb is used. Because dhamb is what personally disappoints you. It's based on levels. When the believers are mentioned, sayyi'at is used. For the believers, sayyi'at. SubhanAllah. There's a difference in standards. A wide difference in standards that is being made clear to us. And this is part of the kawthar Allah has given His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the final thing I wanted to share with you. Acknowledging that when the messenger makes istighfar, that in and of itself is not the same as your istighfar and mine. And even when the messenger feels like he did a sin, it's not actually a sin. He feels that way because his standard is so high. He's that sensitive. So he's making dua, maybe something was missing in my salah. Maybe something I could have done better. Something I may have missed. Maybe I didn't realize. He's constantly introspecting. And this is the attitude of Ibrahim alayhi salam. If you and I go to Hajj, we say, man, subhanAllah, I made Hajj. Ibrahim alayhi salam is building the Kaaba and saying, I don't know if I'm doing a good job, I make tawbah. Watub alayna. They're nervous. They want Allah to accept. Rabbana taqabbal minna. Oh Allah, please accept from us. We don't know if it's good enough, but please accept it from us. This is the attitude we're supposed to have in our acts of ibadah. Because these messengers, especially our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is asking Allah's istighfar, not of sins, in acts that he does to obey Allah. Maybe they're not as good as Allah wanted them to be, and then he's asking Allah he's asking Allah's forgiveness for those. Subhanallah. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us a real love and honor for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah help us understand the Quran properly and live by it. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Quran al Hakim, wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al Hakim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.